So my name is Amarjot and I'm talking to somebody in India for some questions about study visa. What is your name?
Yeah, my name is Rahul and I'm calling from Patiala, Punjab.
You're in Patiala, Punjab. First of all, before we talk about visa or anything else, how are things in Patiala about coronavirus?
Unfortunately, there has been a death today. And there are 5 new cases which have come up in the district because of some people who have eloped out of New Delhi secretly under the eyes of the government and its authorities. So they have been causing many more cases in the area because they have kind of eloped from Delhi last night at around 3 a.m. And they reached here and they were suspected and they were taken away to Rajendra Hospital.
Okay. All right, thank you. What is your profession? What do you do?
I am basically a certified financial planner and I am a SEBI registered investment advisor. So I hold many sort of certifications and designations which are required by Government of India to practice as an investment advisor here in India.
I have some questions for you. Can ask me questions. So the certified planner title is given by who? What is the organization that gives you the CFP title?
The organization which gives us this title is FPSB, Financial Planning Standard Board. It is the same body which gives this designation in the US and also in Canada.
Good. And with the CFP title, you can sell securities, you can sell mutual funds, bonds.
Basically, that is something which a broker does. What we do is we do fee only planning. So we look at your financial health, we look at your requirements and your goals, and we give you a prescription on the basis of a certain fee that is charged on an annual basis. And then the application is being referred to a broker, which sells you products like mutual funds and insurance, whatever you have been talking about.
For how many years have you been in the financial planning industry? How many years?
I'm a recent graduate, so it's not been a year till date.
Recent graduate means last year?
Yes.
You did BCom, BSc, something, BA?
I have done my BCom. I have done my MCom. I have done many certifications as far as this domain is concerned of personal finance. And I have satisfied the requirements as by the market regulator, SEBI in India.
Good.
By passing all exams of the CFP.
So are you pretty successful in India? I mean, you must be doing good. Why are you going to Canada?
Yeah. So my reason is, as you know, in Canada, the present scenario, the present changing demographics, there are a lot of baby boomers, which require a lot of financial advisory. Okay. In India, unfortunately, the concept of fee-only planning has not got to a level whereby ordinary people are comfortable with paying a fee. The much more prevalent model over here is a kind of model which is commission-based, whereby you kind of push a certain product and you get a certain amount of money as commission. So Canada being a much more evolved market, right? So there is a great opportunity with baby boomers increasing by every day. They need persons who specialize into personal finance to get advisory on how to manage their money going ahead.
How do you compare regarding this market with America, England, and Australia? Those markets are also mature and attractive for somebody like you.
That is true. But looking at the kind of the friendly environment Canadians have, the kind of acceptability towards foreign nationals and foreign cultures that they have, it is much more easier to work and to adapt into Canadian culture than something like Australia and the US.
Have you been to US and Australia?
No, it is all on the basis of my observation in the media, in the news, what I hear, what I read. So that is what I have come to conclusion myself.
Or is it perhaps that you want to become a permanent immigrant into Canada rather than some other country where the policies may not be too friendly?
No, I wish to open my own practice over here And I'm specifically looking out for a program which kind of instills the selling and marketing techniques as far as core financial planning practice is concerned. So as I was making my search, there is no MBA program specifically in India which relates to financial services. While they do have such program in Canada, in one of the most prestigious institutions by the name of George Brown, in the Financial Center of Toronto.
Okay.
So I'm looking out for that program.
Well, seems like you have made some homework and preparation for yourself. What is your confusion that you want to ask me any question regarding it? What is your question for me?
The confusion is in regards to the gap year. Now, a person, let's say, has three qualifications, qualification A, B, and C. Now, do they refer to a gap year when the gap year is exercised between two qualifications, or the gap year is counted from the last certification or qualification that you have added to your kind of arsenal? So what do you mean by gap year?
So we will answer this question one by one. So the gap year does not relate to you because you have a MCOM last year, so you have hardly any gap.
MCOM was done in 2016.
Yeah, it's not. So it is always treated from the last qualification, which is your MCOM. So that is the answer to your question. But as I see, if you have 2 years of gap, 2016, you have, 4 years of gap. It is inconsequential. It is very insignificant for somebody like you, because if you have a consistent career history and stable academic path, even though, you know, that's fine. Gaps are always, it's not.
Because I was of the delusion that they only consider a university degree or university certification or a university, let's say, post-graduation as something which marks your education credentials. So I am not sure whether they consider certifications as education or not.
But I will answer that question as well. Any membership like CFP or a chartered accountant or company secretary, these are not academic qualifications as far as Canada is concerned. Maybe in express entry and other things, they are not considered academic degree qualifications. They are just a membership of a profession for you, but it has nothing to do with your with somebody to where you can claim some points. As far as study visa is concerned, George Brown, I do not know how you have decided. George Brown is a prestigious college. I'm not an academic expert, but I can tell you George Brown is not as prestigious as any other alternates. My recommendation to you is that you should target a university, a big university like University of Toronto, University of British Columbia, or any university actually.
Very correct as you say so, but one needs to find a similar program as one is looking out for. Well, so the best for my case was George Brown in this case.
Well, here's let me give you my advice, and then you can decide to follow or whatever you can benefit by. That's fine. The challenge I see is that you already are highly qualified. You already have an MCOM, and then if you are going to Canada for a specialized program that is good for a study visa. But if you are going from a master's, like a university level program, to a junior college, which is George Brown, it downgrades your academic credentials in perception to the visa officer. I think you should stay at the level of master's degree, like a PG diploma or another master's program.
Is a postgraduate certificate.
Can I finish my talk?
All right. Yes, please.
Just wait. So I think from the point of view of the visa, of the student visa evaluation, I would rather have you stay at the PG level, maybe a postgraduate certificate of 1 year or 2 year, or maybe a degree itself at the university level. That is looking at the chances of maximizing the visa application for you. So that if you go to a junior college, which is George Brown is a college where people would go typically after doing grade 12, maybe 10 plus 2, or maybe after bachelor's degree. That is where, if you went to George Brown right now, and many Canadians who are living here, they are watching and hearing us, they will attest that these colleges like George Brown, Sheridan, Seneca, and there are a number of them in Toronto area. I think the Toronto area is full of this college industry. I think all of these colleges attract people who are at the very basic level after high school, after perhaps maybe, you know, bachelor's degree, very few after MCOM, very few after master's degree. So I want you to be successful. I don't want you to get rejection by the New Delhi High Commission saying that this course is not consistent with your background. So that is what it is. But if you cannot find anything relating to your background in the university level, you have to keep searching, keep looking, find out something else. It is always is a possibility that later on when you go to Canada, if you take, for example, something in MBA finance or, you know, anything in finance, you can always change your major after a semester or two. You can always switch around while in Canada. But I prefer for a study visa that you should go at the level of a professional. I think you are looking yourself as a student, but I don't see you as a minor student. I see you as a professional trying to upgrade your levels. So that is what it is. What is the question regarding this now?
Yeah, just to add on, the program I'm looking out for, it is a postgraduate certificate coming with 4 months of co-op.
Okay.
Yeah, so that is the way. So that, I think, is at the postgraduate level in Canada, postgraduate certificate.
Well, I'm sure it is. But, you know, given the choice, if you have no choice, then, you know, you will proceed. But given the choice between a college and a universities, our universities always have an upper hand as far as visa is concerned. There's no doubt about it. You know, if you look at the statistics of the Canadian High Commission for the past 10 years, I think... Mm-hmm. The people who are going to a university have a higher approval rate than a college. No, absolutely no doubt about it.
Mm-hmm. Coming to my question, which was in regards to the certifications, professional certifications from institutes within India or outside India, whether they are considered as somebody continuing his education or they only look at credentials coming from a college or from a university within India.
In your case, the most likely chances are the admissions office at George Brown will look at your degrees plus your membership in these institutes to get a balanced view of what your study aims are. Because MCOM, you know, those are routine degrees, but if you have excess, you know, professional certifications just like what you have, I think this will create a great bonus for you to get admission. I have no doubt that you will get the admission, but if I were you, I would just not be satisfied only by the admission. I think you should seek some scholarship, and mm-hmm. because you are a financial planner, you know that every penny counts. I would recommend that you should shortlist at least two, three university and colleges, and then get admission in all of them and try to shop around for the best scholarship deal. In fact, you should assertively ask them that, do you have a student aid or for international students, or do you have a graduate assistantship working with a professor in finance, maybe on a part-time basis? I think that is what you should demand, and search out the best college option. That is what I would recommend to you.
I have been successfully working on that ground, sir. And just to give you the information that I've received, the scholarships that they have been giving out for the international students as far as George Brown College, King Street, Toronto is concerned, what they do is they give it out to you on the basis of the performance, the academic performance in semester one. So that is how the criterion has been set by them, rather than giving it to somebody before admissions take place.
Well, and this is now the difference between a college and a university. But I know I have many examples. I am in Alberta. I know in University of Alberta, they are extremely well funded. Colleges do not have as much money as universities, and universities are more flexible in giving you scholarship. Is not only just giving money. Scholarships is also in the terms of reducing your fees by like 25% or 50%, giving you a part-time job working with the office, with the somebody in the department where you are, or maybe giving you a pre-arranged, job working on a project in your subject. Those are the types of, grants and aids that you can get. Colleges, if colleges start distributing money left and right, they will lose money. They are not in the business of giving free money. But you as a skillful financial planner, you should always shop around and find out where the best deal is, because hey, it is your future. If you have excess money, you can throw it out. If you have, why not? But if you do not, and if you want to capitalize on your strengths of your financial planning background, you should be able to win over some kind of assistance. And that is why I always prefer that we go to universities. I'm not saying that colleges are bad, but I think if you want to make your career in Canada and have a good chance, maybe attracting solid part-time job opportunities and maybe making contacts with other people for the future job, there's no comparison between universities and colleges, no comparison at all.
Okay, wonderful. I will work on your suggestion, sir. Thank you so much for giving out your valuable time. You have been doing great work in kind of unearthing the kind of boguses Indians are suffering with today. And I'm a great fan. I watch every episode of yours. May Vaheguru bless you. You are doing excellent work, sir. Thank you. And please go ahead and flag forward. And there are very few people in immigration business as you are. My best wishes. Yeah, my prayers.
Good luck to you.